Welcome back to Simplifying Synthesis. In this video, we're going to look at the total synthesis of Dysifragilones A and B and Dysidavarones C. This synthesis was published by the group of Hongbo Quinn in Org Lett in August of 2021. Dysidavarones A to D were first identified in 2012, and Dysifragilones A to C were identified in 2015 by Lin et al. From the South China Sea sponge Dysidavarone. Dysidavarones A and D both show inhibitory effects in cancer cells, while Dysifragilones show anti-inflammatory effects with stronger activity on the inhibition of the production of NO than hydrocortisone. This makes these families of compounds interesting targets for organic synthesis, with the aim of exploring and optimizing these biological effects. The challenges associated with synthesizing the Dysifragilones and the related Dysidavarones come from the construction of the highly substituted quinone ring. This forms part of the carbon framework of the molecule, which is comprised of four fused rings. This carbon framework contains three quaternary stereocenters, all of which must be controlled to achieve the correct structure. So let's look at the retrosynthesis. Dysidavarone C can first be disconnected at the ethoxyenol ether, leading back to a methoxy ether. The two exoalkenes present could be installed using Wittig chemistry. For the Dysifragilones, the first disconnection can also occur at this alpha position, here disconnecting the amine groups, again leading back to an alpha-methoxyenol ether. Disconnecting the carbon-carbon bond of the five-membered ring leads back to an alpha-brominated quinone and a six-membered ring bearing an exoalkene. These intermediates, the Dysifragilones and Dysidavarone C, can both be disconnected back to a common intermediate using either Wittig chemistry or a palladium-catalysed coupling. This common intermediate contains a polyoxygenated aromatic ring bearing a bromide and a six-membered ring bearing a ketone. Disconnecting this molecule leads back to two fragments, a highly functionalized aromatic ring and a tricyclic enone, which is easily accessed from the Weiland-Meischer ketone. The aromatic intermediate can ultimately be derived from a previously reported trimethoxybromobenzaldehyde. So let's start with the synthesis of this aromatic compound. The first step is the reduction of the aldehyde using sodium borohydride. The resulting alcohol is then reacted with phosphorus tribromide, which acts as an electrophile and is attacked by the hydroxyl group, which displaces a bromide, forming the activated oxygen species, which undergoes an SN2 displacement by the bromide. This formed the target compound, which was taken to the next step without purification. This next step was the alkylation with the ketone derived from the Weiland-Meischer ketone. To generate the necessary enolate, the authors used a Birch reduction. This uses a mixture of lithium in ammonia, which generates solvated electrons. This electron adds to the beta position of the enone and leaves a radical on the tertiary alpha carbon. This radical is further reduced to form an anion together with the protonation of the beta position and the formation of the desired enolate. This method was used as it forms the thermodynamic enolate, with the anion residing on the tertiary carbon as opposed to other methods which could form the enolate on either side of the carbonyl group. This enolate then attacks the alkyl bromide, which forms the common intermediate in a 70% yield. This reaction was stereoselective, and this is due to the steric hindrance caused by the fused ring system of the nucleophile. The ketone was then reacted in a Wittig reaction. Triphenylmethylphosphoniumbromide was deprotonated by potassium terpbutoxide to generate the phosphonium ilate. This reacted with the carbamyl group, forming a four-membered oxyphosphatane ring. This intermediate decomposed with the elimination of triphenylphosphine oxide and the formation of the exoalkene in an 89% yield. With this alkene installed, the stage was set for a reductive Heck reaction. Tetracyclic triphenylphosphine palladium was used as the catalyst for the reaction, which first undergoes an oxidative addition into the carbon-bromine bond. This then undergoes a migratory insertion into the alkene, forming a new carbon-carbon bond. The reaction of this intermediate with sodium formate generates a palladium hydride species together with the elimination of sodium bromide and carbon dioxide. This palladium hydride then undergoes a reductive elimination to form the target compound in a 90% yield. With the four rings required for the final products now installed, The acetal was deprotected using hydrochloric acid, and the resulting ketone was once again reacted in a Wittig reaction to generate the exoalkene in a 95% yield over two steps. This exoalkene was then induced to rearrange using tosylic acid. This protonates the double bond, generating a cation on the tertiary carbon centre and promotes the elimination of a proton to form the more thermodynamically stable endoalkene. With this in place, the compound was then oxidised using cerium ammonium nitrate to produce the quinone ring in an 87% yield. Both dysifragilones A and B could be accessed from this intermediate by refluxing the compounds with the required amine to generate dysifragilone A in a 70% yield and dysifragilone B in a 94% yield. To synthesize dysidavarone C, the ketone intermediate was reacted in an α-arylation, again using a palladium catalyst, this time palladium diacetate. As before, the first step was an oxidative insertion into the carbon-bromine bond. An enolate is then formed, promoted by the presence of cesium carbonate. This undergoes a ligand substitution with the bromide ligand, forming a bond between the alpha position of the ketone and the palladium. This then undergoes a reductive elimination to produce the product in a 94% yield. As we saw earlier, hydrochloric acid was used to deprotect the acetal, and a Wittig reaction was used to install the exocyclic alkenes, this time reacting with both ketones present in the molecule, forming the target compound in an 80% yield over two steps. The structure of this intermediate was proven using X-ray crystallography, which shows a transfused linkage between the 6-membered ring and the 8-membered ring, with a quaternary methyl group occupying the axial position. To complete the synthesis, the aromatic ring was oxidized using CAN to produce the quinone in an 87% yield, and refluxing this in ethanol produced the target in an 86% yield. Overall, this is a highly modular synthetic scheme to these two related families of compounds. This divergent strategy can produce the dysifragilones in just 8 steps and dysidavarone in 6 steps, and could easily be modified to synthesize other members of these families, and will no doubt be used to great effect to explore the biological activities of these novel compounds. That's everything for this week's Simplifying Synthesis. If you enjoy these videos, please like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. In the next video, we will look at the total synthesis of nesterol A.